everybody. Start to worship. Come on.
In tenderness he sought me, weary and sick with sin. And on his shoulders brought me back to his fold again. While angels in his presence till the courts of heaven rang, oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold of God, the grace that brought me to the fold of God. Died for me while I was sinning, needy and poor and blind. He whispered to assure me, I found thee, thou art mine. And I'd never heard a sweeter voice.
Good evening, everybody.
I just saw your face.
That was amazing.
All right. Welcome to the night session. We've got one that I'm sure everybody knows, so let's sing it out.
Thank you.
creation of water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. So glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. Darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are pray. Father in heaven, we are grateful to be together another night. We are grateful to be known and loved by you and to know and love one another. And so we pray that as we sing a couple more songs, that your presence would make itself known to us, that we would be more aware of the fact that you're here with us. More aware of your love, your grace, your justice, and your mercy for us.
Though the earth cried out for blood, satisfied her hunger was. Billows calmed on raging seas, for the souls of men she craved. Sun and moon from balcony turned their head in disbelief.
Precious love would taste the sting, disfigured and distinct. Friday a thief, Sunday a king. Laid down in grief, but awoke with the keys of hell on that day. The firstborn of the slain, the man Jesus Christ laid death in his grave. So 3 days in darkness slept, the morning sun of righteousness arose to shame the throes of death and overturn his rule. Our daughters and the sons of men would pay not their dues again. The debt of blood they owed was rent on the day he rolled the new. On Friday a thief, Sunday a king. Laid down in grief, but awoke with the keys of hell on that day. The firstborn of the slain, the man Jesus Christ laid death in his grave. Praises to your name.
name is life. Your name is hope inside me. It's hope inside me. Your name is love. It's a love that always finds me. It always finds me. Come on. Your name is life. Your name is hope inside me. Hope inside me. Your name is love. It's a love that always finds me. Always finds me. Oh! Be lifted.
Place is just that, lifted up, lifted above, on the throne of all things seen and unseen. Everything is in its proper place, subject under you, under your rule and your reign and your authority. So Father, your church is crying, be lifted up, not because you're not, but because it's exactly where you belong. And with you, risen with you, is right where we belong. So Lord, we cry, be lifted up in our neighborhoods, in our homes, in our nations. Lord, be lifted high in our lives. That the world would know exactly who you are, where you belong, and where it belongs in your love, Lord. We are grateful to do that together. And we all said, amen. Good to praise.
Oh, wow. You're ready to just get things going. And that's the Peru. That's the good stuff. That's the Peruvian chocolate. All right. We had such an amazing morning. Was anyone else stoked to hear those ladies this morning? Was that just so awesome? Yeah.
It's ladies' power.
Ladies' power, yes.
Yes.
So the coolest thing, though, Aldo, today, is I had more men come up to me and say thank you that those women were on the panel today.
Amen.
I was not expecting that.
Why not?
I guess I underestimated you guys or something.
No,
I don't know.
No. We realize that power.
But I had so many men come up and say that they wish their wives and daughters were here to just be inspired. And that was so meaningful. So all you four panelists that were there this morning, thank you so much for sharing. I think a lot of people were inspired.
Yep.
All right. Are we ready to have some fun, though?
Yes, of course.
Of course. Of course. All right, Aldo.
Yes.
You are going to be the demonstrator today.
Okay.
As well as Riley. Where's Riley Owens? All right, we're going to play a little game. And we've played a few games that are up on stage, but we're going to do a game now where everybody's involved. This is called, who said whoa? Thanks, Kelsey. All right, this is called rock, paper, scissors. But it's not just the normal rock, paper, scissors shoot, right? This is something different. It's a full body experience here. And every one of you are going to play. So we're going to do a little demonstration. You're married? I think rock, paper, scissors is a little different in Peru. Here in the States? All right. Okay, Aldo, don't worry. Aldo, you stay on this side. Riley's over here. Okay, you guys aren't going to like... She's Venezuelan? Oh, okay. All right, rock is this. Okay, oh, you don't have to get all the way down. Paper is this, and scissors is this, okay? So I'm going to say rock, paper, scissors, shoot, and then you do your thing, okay? Here we go, ready? Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Okay, so Aldo just won, so Riley's out, all right? And we're going to do the finals here, and we're going to go all the way. Everyone in the room, wait, oh,
okay, wait. That is great. I know, you did win. Hi, can I shake your hand? Okay. Thank you for not proposing to me or anything. Okay, but that's fun. We're going to take it next level, though. Okay? Okay, so once you win, so Aldo, right? Okay, so Aldo just beat me. Now I am Aldo's biggest fan. Okay, I'm going to follow him. Dylan, you're next. Come on up. And Dylan and Aldo are going to play, okay? So I'm going to be on Aldo's team. Aldo, 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 Aldo. Okay, so y'all are going to play. Okay, oh, here we go, Aldo. Everybody's on this team. Okay, so you two play, ready? Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Oh, so he just got you. Or is that a scissor? I'm not sure. Okay, scissors is both legs and arms. Okay, whoa. Okay, you were paper. So now Dylan just beat you. So now we are on Dylan's team. Dylan, Dylan, Dylan. Okay, so you get the concept. Now we're going to keep playing until there are two people left. And one person is going to be the biggest winner of Rock, Paper, Scissors. Okay, so remember, once you play somebody... You then get absorbed into the team that you lost to, okay? And then you're going to find another group, and you'll be little blobs walking around until there's two big blobs, and then we'll lift the person up and chant their name, okay?
All right.
Okay, so everybody stand up.
Come up here so they can see.
Everybody go ahead and stand up. And go ahead and get started. I don't want to have to count it off for you because that'll get too crazy. Do they have music? All right, 3, 2, 1, go!
Ready? All right, keep it going, keep moving. This is not 2 out of 3. This is not 2 out of 3, one game.
Tenderness, he saw me. Weary and sick with sin. And on his shoulders.
All right, I gotta hear you chant each other's names. Chant people's names. I don't hear any names.
who's he versing? All right, this, hold on. Are we in the finals? Okay, hold on. Okay, come on, let's go, Steve. You're up to the front. All right, I think, Steve? Everybody can take a seat except Steve over here.
I blame you, Sam. I blame you.
All right, Steve, I feel like you need a victory speech. I mean, you had so many fans behind you. So I think you need to thank your fans.
Aussie, Aussie, Aussie! Aussie, Aussie, Aussie!
All right, that's a great speech. Wow. Woo. Aldo, what did you think of that?
Oh, well, that was a great demonstration of teamwork and how the public would support their team.
It's a lot of energy now in this room. That was incredible.
Okay, just to say one thing. As we have not received any other challenge for the future, tomorrow we are challenging the Aussies with the Vegemite.
Oh, the Aussies?
Yes, the Peruvians are challenging the Aussies if they have come with their thing that called Vegemite. Or whatever they want. If not, if they are not ready, we are challenging the U.S. with another sauce they have.
I mean, the U.S. is known for their sauces.
No. Come on.
Have you seen Velveeta cheese?
Yes. That's okay.
It's legit.
Okay.
All right.
That's for tomorrow.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and move on, although you can go ahead and sit down.
It's ladies' night.
It's ladies' night. We are going to bring up one of our newest members of our staff here at CSUS. One of the things at CSUS we've been trying to really drive home is the importance of women in our chapters. Oh, wow, now we have a balloon going. We got rock, paper, scissors. We're out of control tonight. All right, Colby King, can you come on up? Yeah. Yeah. Oh. Colby, here are your notes. Colby is from Florida, and she is our East Coast Girls Coordinator. So Colby's job is to make sure that there is female representation in the leadership of all the chapters on the East Coast. It's a pretty big job. How's it going so far? You've been in about 3 months?
Yeah.
Officially.
It's going. It's awesome. It's really good.
So one really cool thing that we got to do is back in June, Colby and I got to co-lead a trip to Nicaragua. And David and I have led mission groups, you know, for quite a few years. And to lead a women's group with Colby was a whole different experience. It was like nothing I could ever explain. To have just a group of women, like-minded women, serving the women of Nicaragua, which Colby's going to share a little bit more about. But I love David and I love going on co-ed trips. But I'm telling you, there was nothing like the experience that we had in Nicaragua. So Colby's going to share a little bit about that tonight.
Thank you. Amy, the feeling is definitely mutual. So one thing first, it is ladies' night. However, I just want to preface, I would not be where I'm at today without my brothers. I have three amazing brothers that just love the Lord and love me. And I just want the men in the room to know that. Like, I'm behind every strong woman, honestly, is a killer man. So I thank you all, strong men, for being here as well. But now we're going to switch it back over to the ladies. So like Amy said, we had the privilege of going to Nicaragua and serving the women there. And mind you, this was the first ever all-girls United States trip. So Amy and I had prayed about it, and we decided, hey, let's go to Nicaragua. And I had never planned a mission trip before. I'd traveled with Christian surfers, I'd planned trips for myself, but never a surf and serve.
And man, Amy and I, we worked very hard for this trip. We hashed it out, so many Zoom calls, so many meetings, so many ridiculous questions that we had to answer up until the day we flew out. And so once we finally got to Nicaragua, it was incredible to see the fruits of our labor. And if you don't mind, we actually have a couple slides as well. So we put all of this effort into this trip for 8 or 9 months. That's us frothing at Lance's left. However, everything you could imagine that could go wrong on a trip literally went wrong. So, first of all, we're not even at the airport yet, and a group of us wake up at 3 a.m. and realize our flight was canceled. Like, it's not postponed, it's just canceled. Have no idea why. And then that means it resulted in us staying at the airport counter for 3 hours trying to get everything situated. Still have no idea why it was canceled, but it was. So no worries. All the girls got on their flight, except for me and one other girl. We were put on a flight to Texas. Literally no reason, no reason. And so we're on this flight, and before they take off, the flight attendant comes up and says, hey, there's 2 extra seats on the correct flight you're supposed to be on. So me and this other girl, we go on the correct flight, everything's all good. And so we get there, and they had checked our baggage to Texas. So if you've ever been on a surf trip and you don't have your own boards, that is a bummer. We also didn't have our clothes, but that was beside the point. So that was definitely a bummer. So that's just one thing that happened. And now, one of the things, I'm not sure if you've noticed, but COVID has just really messed everything up. And so tickets into Nicaragua were crazy expensive. And Amy had this brilliant idea of, hey, let's fly into Costa Rica, save a couple $100, and let's just walk across the border to Nicaragua. So that's what we did. However, it was pouring rain. I'm from Florida, so I can handle rain, you know? This was unreal the entire time. So we're carrying our board bags, most of which don't have wheels, and we're lugging them along with our suitcases. Not me, because I didn't have my board bag, so that was a win. But this was probably a 3-hour journey, not walking in the rain for 3 hours, but in total. It was just brutal. So we're not even in Nicaragua yet, and this trip has just been hard. It's just been really stinking rough. So finally get to Nicaragua. It's awesome. Like Amy shared, we were able to serve the women in the community, and our primary focus was on purity. So purity in mind, purity in body, and purity in their relationship with Christ. And it was really cool how real and vulnerable we were able to get with not only the women in Nicaragua, but also the girls we paddle out with. You know, it's super easy to be vulnerable with these people on mission trips you might never see again. But it's a whole nother level of vulnerability when, you know, once you get home, you're going to paddle back out with these people. So that was really special. However, one thing with Christian surfers is we all come from very different backgrounds. Some of us are still trying to figure out our faith. Others, like, we know where we stand and we're not going to budge. And oftentimes that's something that creates friction. So one of the days on the trip, there was some spiritual friction, which left and ended in one girl being upset, and everything worked out really well. But again, this trip, everything that Amy and I had really worked for just wasn't working. It wasn't the perfect trip. It wasn't the trip we had prayed for. And then this is literally where I was about to lose my mind. So one of the first photos was us at Lance's left, and it's every goofy footer's dream. It's just this perfect reef break, and it obviously peels left. It's Lance's left. It's not Ricky's right. I'm just kidding. That's not a surf spot. All the girls were like, oh, when are we going to go surf a right? And okay. So what's really cool about Lance's left is that's what you're overlooking. You can't paddle out to it. You literally have to take a boat to it. And this is a day that all of us were just frothing over. Like, we did a ton of mission work, and we surfed some beach breaks. But this was the day where we were just going to have so much fun. So we put the boat in the water, we go out, and it's magical. You jump off the boat, and there's this perfect wave. So we jump off. All the girls are ripping. We catch some killer waves. I catch this super, super sick wave after catching a lot of waves. And then I come back around, and I get stuck on the inside. And so I'm just fighting and fighting and fighting. And you know, after you, like, are fighting the inside, you're just exhausted. So I'm new to shortboarding, so I was extremely exhausted. And I went to duck dive. And when I duck dove, the wave was so powerful, it took the board out of my hands. And my leash broke. And this has never happened to me, let alone in a foreign country. I'd never had a leash break on me before. And a lot of times, I think I would have maybe just swam back to shore. But like I said, you couldn't swim back to shore because it's just rocks. It's just this giant cliff. So I immediately lock eyes with one of the girls that's on the trip. She's an incredibly talented lifeguard. She comes over. She swims to me with her board. She jumps off her board. She gives me her board. And she starts kicking me back to the boat. And if you surf, you know that you're never going to end a session on a bad wave. Even if you were supposed to get out of the water 20 minutes ago. You need that good wave to be able to go home. So I get back to the boat, and I just see my board hitting these rocks. And this is the first day I finally got to surf my own board, because remember, I didn't have my boards for the rest of the trip. So I finally surf, and then I just see my board hitting the rocks. And I'm very frustrated, and they take the boat to shore, and they pick my board up, and it's epoxy, so it wasn't really harmed, thank God. And so Gracie gives me her leash, and I decide to catch one more wave in. So I catch one more wave, and it's good. And I'm like, all right, I've had my fill. And I was finally ready to listen to God. And so this whole trip has just not been what I'd prayed for. It's not been what Amy and I had worked for. And so I'm paddling back to the boat, and I pray. And I'm like, Lord, what are you trying to teach me? That's it. That's all I asked. And God said one word after I'd had probably just the scariest surf session of my life. After this week has just been stacked with difficulty and difficulty and difficulty, the Lord said one word, and he said, resilience. Literally not what I wanted to hear. So we get back in the boat, and we go back to the car, and we get back to Wi-Fi. And when I ask the Lord a question, I really want an answer, and when he gives me an answer, it usually means I need to look something up because I don't really understand it. So I looked up the word resilience. And the word resilience, it means able to withstand or recover quickly from difficult conditions. Resilience means able to recoil or spring back into shape after bending, stretching, or being compressed. That trip, the Lord definitely taught me resilience. I think he taught a lot of the other women resilience on that trip as well. And you know, that is the heart of Christian Surfers Girls, not just in the United States, but across the world, is we want to teach these women resilience. Resilience in the water, resilience in their friendships, and resilience in their marriages, resilience wherever they go, and most importantly, resilience in the Lord. And I just want to spend a time closing in prayer for resilience, not only over these females, but over the men that help cover these females as well. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for who you are, and we thank you for how well you love us. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be sweet and tender and meek, but we also thank you for a spirit of resilience, a spirit that is not willing to give up, not willing to let go, and not willing to bow down. And Father, we know that that resilience comes only from you. And Lord, that's what we pray for, a spirit of resilience over the world when it comes to Christian Surfers females, and resilience over these men that are helping us, whether that looks one way or another. Lord, we just thank you for who you are, and we thank you for your mercy, and we thank you for your truth, and we thank you for your grace. Amen. Thank you, guys.
What's really cool is we have just seen so much fruit come from this trip.
Waiting at the light, sitting at the cross, hoping the time would stop.
Awesome. No, what I was going to say is it's just awesome to see the fruit come from it. We have so many girls that have stepped up as chapter leaders from that trip. We have one girl from our trip that has decided to give her life to full-time ministry down in Nicaragua starting in January. So how awesome is that? So the trip was hard, but the fruit from it was incredible, and we have friendships for a lifetime from it. All right, so now we are going to introduce our key speaker tonight. Now this woman, let me tell you, I have been, as you guys have noticed from all the different speakers, I have been digging on information on these different speakers to get some funny stories, and it's been easy. Right? Like, I asked for some stories on Nick and, like, 10 people. Let me tell you stories. Roy, oh, man, every hand went up in the room with, I saw him naked here. And it's just been, like, one story after another. And so finally, tonight, V's up. And I'm, yeah, give it up for V. Woo! So I'm asking around, you know? I mean, I've known V for a couple years now, and every time I see her, she's just so hospitable and so kind, and she has so much wisdom and so much Bible knowledge. And I'm like, okay, there's got to be some dirt on this girl, right? We've got to get a good story out of her. And every time somebody speaks, it's just with such admiration of her. And the verse kept coming up that charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, which V is both. But a woman who fears the Lord is worthy to be praised. And that was V's story over and over and over. And even today, so finally we're in this woman, you know, gathering today, and everybody's like, woman power, yeah, let's go, let's do it. Let's, you know, not that we're gonna take over the men, but by any means, we love you guys so much. We cannot wait to partner with you. We love you. But all of us women are getting all excited, and then V speaks. And she's like, but no matter what we do it with love, and we do it with sweetness, and with humility, and we're all like, oh, yeah, you're right. Such a humbling experience. But this woman, she's been an ordained pastor for 15 years. She was a regional coordinator of Australia, a national director of Australia, and now we have the honor of hearing her speak tonight. So let's welcome V to the stage.
There's some stories out there about me. There are. They're just all hidden away in Australia. I've been here in the States for 9 years, and I've kept my head down. Been busy with my children, but yeah, there's a few out there, Amy. And I just want to say I was never a national director in Australia. We were regional coordinators, and my husband Nick was national manager with Steve for a long time, but that was never me. But thank you. What an honor to stand here tonight and wrap up this day of celebrating women in mission. I mean, hey, this doesn't happen very often that there's an organization that's willing to say, we're going to commit a whole day to celebrating the women in our midst. And so I just want to shout out to Roy and Sharon and all the national leaders. This is amazing. This is really a special thing, and I feel very honored to stand here and wrap it up. You know, we've been sitting in the book of Acts the last few days, and Nick left us this morning right at the point where God pours out the Spirit on the day of Pentecost, and it was pretty cool to think about that happening, about, you know, the crazy stuff with tongues of fire and the wind. Some pretty amazing stuff happened, and as this kind of commotion was going on, they somehow moved to the temple, as Nick was saying, because thousands of people gathered, and Peter stood up and he spoke to the people, and he spoke out of the book of Joel, and that's where I want to land tonight with you guys as we wrap up this amazing day. In the book of Joel, so if you have your old paper Bibles, open them up. Does anyone, any of you ladies or any of you men out there want to read for me? I think we have a microphone somewhere. Well, yeah. I'm going to need this later. Chad's got his Bible. Chad, would you read Joel for me?
On my phone?
Yeah, or you can use mine. Mine's very tiny.
I'll read yours.
Okay, so Chad's going to read Joel for us, chapter 2. We're going from verse 28 through to 32.
To 32.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
To the end.
The day of the Lord, and afterward I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls.
Thank you. Let me pray. Well, Lord, we come tonight to sit at your feet and to just spend some time in your word, Lord. And we ask that your spirit would be present, as we know it is. Lord, we ask that you would just shine your light on our hearts through your word. We pray that you'd be speaking to us. We pray that your wisdom would flow through this room. We pray that you'd be glorified by what we talk about tonight. We just commit all these things into your hands, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. So I wanted to start by telling you the story of a leader of a nation, someone who sat as a judge, someone who was filled with the Holy Spirit. And this woman's name was Deborah, and you'll find her story in the book of Judges in chapter 4. And she was a really interesting lady. She is recorded as being the only woman who led Israel during this time before the Israelites got the king that they wanted when Samuel finally anointed Saul. But she's a leader of her people. She's filled with the Holy Spirit. She's a prophet. And back in those days, before the day of Pentecost, not everyone was filled with the Spirit. Just a few people got anointed with the Spirit of God. They were set aside for a certain purpose, and Deborah was one of those people. So she led her people, she heard from God, and one day God speaks to her, and he says, it's time. It's time to fight the Canaanites who have been oppressing you for 20 years. They've been cruelly oppressed by King Jabin. It's time. Call the leader of your army, call him in. We're gonna go into battle, and we're going to get free. So she calls in Barak, who's the commander of the Israelite army, and she lays out the plan for him. We're gonna gather our forces, and we're gonna go down, and we're gonna get free from Canaan. And he is a little hesitant. He says to her, okay, I'll go, but only if you go with me. If you don't go, I'm not going. And I kind of feel sorry for Barak, because you know, he didn't have the Spirit of God in him. He didn't have the Holy Spirit. He just knew that she did, and he wanted her with him. But so she says to him, well, okay, yes, I will go with you into battle, but because you are hesitating, the victory here will not be given to you. The honor of killing the commander of the enemy will actually go to a woman. So Deborah, she walks into battle with her people, because you know, the Israelites didn't ride horses. I was investigating this, thought it was so fascinating. They went into battle on foot. And you know, Barak was pretty hesitant because the Canaanites had like 900 iron chariots. They had horses. They were a well-equipped army. And I guess he knew that it was pretty likely they were going to get thumped. So they ride, or they walk, to face the enemy. And it happens, as the Lord had said to Deborah, they kill every last soldier of their enemy army except for the commander, Sisera. And he flees on foot. He gets out of his chariot and basically runs away. And he goes to the tent of a guy called Heber, the Kenite. Now, for American Australians, it's Heber. For Americans, it's Heber. And Heber, he was an ally of King Jabin. So obviously, Sisera is going to find refuge, to find safety, as his army's been completely destroyed. So he goes to this tent, and there is the wife of Heber. Her name is Jael, and she's obviously been left behind because her husband's gone off to war. And she doesn't hide in the tent. She doesn't pretend she's not home, but he comes to her and she says, come into my tent. And in that culture, the only men who were allowed into a woman's tent was her father or her husband. So it probably seemed like a really good place to go and hide. So she brings him into her tent. He asks for water, but she gives him a glass of milk. She lays him down in a nice, soft bed. And then she takes what she has in her home, a tent peg and a hammer, and she drives the tent peg through his temple and kills him. So, I mean, I'm sure that her bedding was never the same. It'd be hard to get that much blood and brains out of. But I just love this. I love this little snapshot of these two women who serve God in such different ways. They both show up for God. Deborah shows up as a leader of her nation, as a judge, as someone who goes into battle. That was very rare in Israel. Women did not go into battle. On the one hand, you've got this leader of a nation, and then on the other hand, you've got a woman who probably wasn't even an Israelite, but she showed up for God with what she had. She didn't have a sword. She didn't have an axe. She just had a tent peg and a hammer, and she won this great victory for God. So I just wanted to start with that because I think it shows this breadth of what women can do when we choose to show up for God and when we use what we have. So I love thinking through all the ways that women show up in the Bible, because we all know that human beings love to concentrate power in the hands of a few, you know, and in the Jewish nation, it was the Jewish men who had most of the power. The women didn't get to operate in political spheres or economic spheres. They didn't often get to inherit any property. They were kind of, they operated around the edges of leadership. But still, we see them show up in the Bible. I don't have time to talk tonight about Esther or Tamar or Abigail or Ruth, or I mean, there's so many women whose names we know, and it's really remarkable because they existed at a time when women, they existed largely in the home, and they were defined by their relationship to the men around them, which I think is kind of cool because women love men and we love relationships, but that was where they mostly operated, in that sphere. And so when we come to this text in Joel, we see that God's just kind of throwing a spanner in the works. You know, the Jewish people have operated culturally in this way where the men are the stakeholders, the Jewish men, and then suddenly he just throws a bombshell out there. And I love to think of Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9, where God says to us, to the people that he's created, "For your thoughts are not my thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." And I think sometimes we come to a text like this and we read it and we forget that in that cultural context, this was radical, revolutionary. You know, back in those days, not even everyone could operate in the religious rituals. You know, it was just the Levites, the Levite men who could serve in the temple. And here God is saying, "I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy." So it's not just the Jewish men anymore. It's not even just the Jewish men and women. It's everyone. It transcends ethnic boundaries. It transcends gender. This is radical stuff. And he kind of leaves us no wiggle room. You know, he talks about old men. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. You're not ever going to be too old or too young. Sorry, I'm not used to having glasses. I got old somewhere in the last 5 years. Can't read my Bible anymore. So you're never going to be too old. You're never going to be too young in God's kingdom to be empowered with the Spirit. Suddenly, God just says, "I'm going to democratize power in the kingdom of God. It's no longer going to be concentrated in the hands of a few. It's for everyone." And yeah, he's "even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days." So the only restriction placed on it is that you have to be a servant of the Lord to receive this power. Other than that, it's totally inclusive. It's everyone. And that, I mean, we know that's not the way that the world we live in operates. I don't know if you guys can think of any sphere in your life really where power is shared equally amongst everyone. And then it gets a little more interesting as we go on. "I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke." You know, that sounds kind of scary, you know, like Armageddon, blood and fire and billows of smoke. But I think if we remember to look at this through the cross, you know, we're on the other side of the cross, and if we think about the blood, we're actually, through the blood of Jesus shed on the cross, we're actually brought into God's presence. But for that, blood is kind of a terrifying thing, but if we think about it as being that is our entryway into God's presence. And the smoke and the fire, if we think back to Egypt when they were brought out of, sorry, Israel, when they were brought out of Egypt, God led them by day with a pillar of smoke and by night with a pillar of fire. So again, he's like taking these powerful images of his presence and saying, this is what's going to happen when I pour out my spirit on everyone. You all will have access to my presence, and that's what will give you the power to do my will. It's so cool. And then we go on. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. It's really amazing to think about something being great and dreadful all at the same time. I think of many times I've been surfing and the ocean has seemed both great and dreadful to me, terrifying and fun at the same time. And it really depends on where you're standing in relation to the cross as to whether this day of the Lord is going to be great or dreadful. I mean, for the people witnessing God pouring out the Spirit on the day of Pentecost, it was probably a pretty scary and frightening time. But if they knew Jesus, if they were a servant of him, and they received that, it's a totally different perspective. I think often when we talk about the Spirit, we can find ourselves on either side of that. It can seem great and exciting and empowering, or it can seem kind of dreadful and scary and uncontrollable. And then finally, in this passage in Joel, he talks about everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. Joel wrote these words hundreds of years before Jesus was even born. He was born in 585 BC. So we're talking a good long stretch of time between the penning of these words and their fulfillment. And the sentiment of these words, we can kind of look back through Scripture and see that it's not like God's suddenly done a U-turn and changed direction. We can think back to Genesis 1, verse 27, where God said, I have made them in my image, male and female, I have made them. And I think here God is referencing back to this beautiful completeness between men and women, male and female. Together we're made in his image. And the beautiful inclusiveness of the Spirit being poured out is a celebration of that. The Old Testament is full of these stories of women showing up with whatever they had, whatever they had to use. And I just wanted to give, we had an awesome session this afternoon with the ladies. There was a lot of time where we were chatting, where we were sharing what it's like to be in ministry as a woman, and it was pretty cool. And so I'd already invited my friend Hannah to come up and share a little bit of what her experiences have been choosing to show up for God. And so I'm just going to ask Hannah to come up now. What did I do with the microphone? Oh. So Hannah is a local girl. She grew up in Encinitas, and she is now in the Cardiff CS chapter, and she's done lots of cool stuff. So Hannah, can you tell us a little bit about what you've experienced when you've chosen to show up for God?
Hello, my name's Hannah. Nice to see you guys all staring at me. It's great. So, V asked me these questions earlier, and what has it been to, like...
To show up for God. So when he calls you into those spaces that seem scary, or like you're not sure you belong there, or just like showing up, like when you first started that first camp you led with Walking on Water.
Yeah, I feel like it's been an ongoing process of saying yes and being stretched, like a rubber band. I think there's been times where I felt like a rubber band that's like getting pulled like this, and I'm like, I'm gonna snap, and it's just like a continuous pulling, and it's always been like the small things though, like saying yes to like each little step that gets put in front of me and being like, okay, and then going forward and be like, every step leads to something else that's like so special, and it's a crazy journey. Like, I think that's the coolest thing about being a Christian is, like, life isn't boring at all. Like, we get to, like, live these crazy lives that are, like, so packed full of adventure if we say yes.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess for me it's been, like, feeling that stretch of obedience and having to lean on God, feeling mm-hmm. that stretch and not feeling like I could do it on my own.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so Hannah started when, how old were you when you started leading on the camps with Walking on Water?
Yeah, I started Walking on Water. And I started going there when I was, like, in junior high. And then they let me go to the high school camp because it was at Trestles. And I was just like, can I stay? And they're like, sure. And so I just ended up going to, like, 2 weeks at Trestles camping out. And then I just started showing up. I didn't pay for the camps. So I was like, when I was 17 and I could drive by myself, I would just show up. And they didn't know what to do with me. They're like, oh, you'll just be a helper. So I, like, they had a position for it later on. I don't know what they call them.
So you pioneered that role by showing up.
Chad did it too. Nina filled that role later. But yeah, just started showing up, and I think being there, like, whenever you show up, usually people will give you a job if you just ask. And so that's kind of so that's kind of how it started, was just showing up and kind of being mentored by one of the older ladies that was running the camp. She just let me, like, buy food with her and sit in the car while she did things. And yeah, it just led to them, like, making me a counselor when I was 19, like, counseling girls that were, like, 18, and be like, I don't think I should be here. But it's crazy, because I think the biggest thing that has come from, like, those experiences is all relationships. Like, they're all, like, experiences of being like, I'm just going to be here and see how they use me. But the relationships, like, with Nina and with, like, the girls, and it's grown, and, like, seeing them, like, step up has been the most powerful thing.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure they've been able to step up because they've seen you ahead of them along the way. Mm-hmm. So my next question for you is, what are some of the things that have stopped you from showing up or have discouraged you from entering into those spaces?
I think the two things for me is whenever I felt like unwanted or unneeded. And those are, I think, two things that maybe everyone feels at certain parts of their life. Unwanted, if, like, you're just like, well, I don't think really they really care if I'm there, or I don't think they really want me. Or unneeded, when, like, oh, I don't really think, I think they can do it without me. Like, I don't think I need to be there. And I think the thing with unwanted, it's like, you're always wanted by God, and it doesn't really matter if people want you. I mean, that's kind of like the people-pleasing thing. And then unneeded, it's like, yeah, we're actually not needed. Like, in the sense, like, God can do it without us. Mm-hmm. Like, he's going to, like, the book of Esther. Like, I love that. Mm-hmm. Because, like, if she didn't step up, somebody else would have, and she would have missed out. And so that feeling of being unwanted or unneeded, it's like, yeah, you're not really needed. But God wants you, like, and he wants you to participate in what he's doing. So I think those are two things that, like, I felt through my life in ministry, and I still feel them sometimes. And it's, like, kind of combating those lies with, like, all right, mm-hmm. like, what does God say?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yay. Yeah, so thanks, Hannah. I called this talk Showing Up because really, in pouring out the Holy Spirit, that was God showing up for us in a new way. And also, I think as we read these stories of women in the Bible, we see them just showing up time after time. We see that when Jesus was walking the earth, the women were there. They were supporting him. They were trailing along. They just kept showing up. They were there when he was crucified. They were there when he rose from the dead. Like, they were literally sitting outside his tomb waiting to see what was going to happen. I mean, they wanted to somehow minister to his body, but something amazing happened because they got up early and they went somewhere. They showed up. And I honestly, it sounds so simple and kind of uncomplicated, but I really think that it's foundational to walking with the Lord, that if you choose to show up somewhere, something happens. You make yourself available for God to work through you. And I do think that often we get discouraged from showing up because we feel there's no space for us, because sometimes as women we can feel like we are only there to maybe make the food or, you know, we all have done a lot of that, and it's a really important part of ministry, but I think that we can easily get discouraged in just choosing to show up every week to your local chapter, just choosing to go to the camp, even when you might have other things to do. God works when we show up. And as we read on after Jesus died into the book of Acts, and look, I just want to talk about two women from the book of Acts. The first is a Mary. We have lots of Marys. This is not Mary, Jesus' mum. This is not Mary Magdalene. This is not Mary, the sister of Lazarus. In fact, I don't think she's in the book of Acts. This is Mary, who is a widow. She's a wealthy widow. She lives in Jerusalem. She has a house that she is in charge of. She runs a large household, and she is friends with the disciples. In fact, she's a believer. And she just takes what she has, and she puts it at the disposal of the disciples. So her house is the house that they go to meet. And it's really cool because the disciples are there. She's friends with Peter. As everyone's basically doing church in this house that belongs to this Mary, her son, John Mark, becomes friends with Peter. And he actually ends up becoming Peter's assistant and writing the book of Mark. John Mark, he takes Peter's memoirs and writes them down. So I kind of like that link, that there's this woman who just takes what she has and offers it for the service of God's people, and her son ends up writing one of the biographies of Jesus. It's really cool. And there's some other really interesting women, but I'm just going to park on Priscilla, who is the wife of Aquila. And she shows up in Acts chapter 18. And she has kind of an interesting life. She's a businesswoman. She works with her husband making tents, like Paul. And Paul is a friend of theirs, and so they invite him to stay with her. The most simple of things. He moves in and lives with them for 18 months. And during that time, obviously, they see him minister. They work with him. They their heads probably grow a lot in terms of their theological knowledge. And then they go with him to Ephesus. And while they're in Ephesus, they meet this guy called Apollos. And he apparently is a really clever, well-educated, articulate man, but he doesn't know the full story. He only knows about Jesus up to John the Baptist. And so Priscilla and Aquila take him and they teach him the whole gospel. And he obviously goes on to minister. And he actually is one of two people that they think may have written the book of Hebrews. So it was either him or Barnabas, scholars think. And again, I just think it's so cool that this woman, she takes what she has, which is her home, and she just offers it for God's service. So simple. We all, pretty much most of us, have a home. We have something we can use. But what's really interesting about Priscilla and Aquila is that, I don't even know how to say his name. Is it Aquila? Anyway, Priscilla and Aquila, their names rhyme. That's kind of cool. When it starts out, talking about them in Acts, it starts with Aquila and Priscilla. His name comes first. And then as this story kind of develops, her name is actually first. It turns into Priscilla and Aquila. And scholars think that's because her ministry maybe just was more, she was more involved in what the church was doing. But that is just, again, a little clue that as women, we have to go and we have to hoover up these clues to find, I guess, a sense that women are able to minister for the Lord in the fullness of the Holy Spirit, in the beautiful fullness of that outpouring at Pentecost. So as women show up and as they use what they have, what is in their hand to serve God, cool stuff happens. And I want to ask up my friend Signe, and she's going to talk to us a little bit about what she has seen happen in her life and the life of her family as she's used what she has. So Signe Castaneda lives in Carlsbad, goes to the CS Carlsbad Mission, mother of six. Mm-hmm. Amazing lady. Anyway, so Sig, I've just seen you over the years use what you have. Mm-hmm. I have to stand down here. Use what you have to serve the Lord. And so can you give us a little bit of a sense of what that's looked like for you?
Yes. First of all, super honored to be asked to speak up here in front of all of you guys, and I see so many faces that are family, and I think it started when our boys were, Carson and Diego, maybe entering their teen years, and there was, for the first time, a space in my life with six young children starting to like not need me every second of the day. And I was like, okay, wow, what does this look like? God, I know that you call everybody into ministry. Even outside my home, I started to feel like, God, I want a ministry larger than just, not just my family, but outside of my family. But I had tried to step outside beyond my family, and it just took too much away from my family, and I got called back pretty quickly. It just didn't work. I said, God, I need something that I can still do, that I'm with my family, but it's serving where they are. And how do I do this, God? Because I feel like there's more. There's something more going on. And thankfully, God did not say, use the hammer and the tent peg, because that would not have gone well. But I sometimes I went, but God, what do I have? What talents do I have? And sometimes we're so close to what we have that we don't see what we can offer. And I knew it was like, okay, I know it's time, I know it's talents, and I know it's the treasures, the resources, but God, what do I have? And I'm like, I don't know. But I kept going to like the CS gatherings after getting out of the water, and like we had pizza, like Costco pizza for literally, I don't know, every single night for a few years or something. And I just heard like this constant repeat of like, I'm hungry. Yeah, but I'm starving. But yeah, like Costco pizza, I'm so over it. And if anyone's been in church life for like any number of years, like you've had your fill of pizza. So I said, well, I could probably just provide a meal. Like that might just give a bit of a reprieve from like pizza night. And so I did that. And then that just started to blossom one thing into the next. And I saw that food I saw God equipping me in this way, like feeding a large family multiple times throughout the day, that I was able to provide this space for people to come and gather. And it just brought people together, but then it just allowed more space to sit and talk and develop those relationships and those friendships. And so then that went on for a while. We did that. And then COVID hit, and the boys were out surfing, and church kind of got mixed up in the midst of all that. Like, and so they were out surfing Sunday mornings, and they would come back with their friends, some who are believers and some who are not, and they'd be hungry, and they're like, hey, can you just cook us up some food, or can we cook food? And so it kind of organically, just as CS, I feel, is, organically began to create this space for people to come. And I was like, oh, this is the unchurched on Sunday mornings. And so for me, it's been this place of trying to provide a bridge between the church and surfers and just a space to get to know God, but primarily around food, which seems so simple, but I think it brings people together in a way that speaks family, that they are known and loved and cared for. And so I heard also God say to me, just start simply, but simply start. And I was like, okay. So one thing led to another.
That's awesome. And so have there been any things along the way that have kind of tried to discourage you from doing that, or kind of excuses that have come up? This is
every day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Every day there's something, like with a large family, or and for me too, it's balancing the needs of our large family, like the capacity of our family, and always wanting to be able to provide an open door for people to come and have a place at the table. And I think it's also discouragement, like Hannah was saying, like, does this really even matter? Like, it's just food. You can go to Lola's and get a burrito. It's the same thing, right? But then I come back to, well, God just said, bring me what you have, your five loaves of bread and your two fishes, and let me do the rest of it. And so that's what I hold on to.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you, Sig. That's so cool. There's something so powerful about just inviting people into your home. And I feel like it's kind of this bedrock of the most simple thing you can do is just to invite people into your home. I'm probably running out of time. Can you just stick up the next slide? Okay, so this young lady lives in Australia. Her name's Serena, and I just wanted to finish with the story about her. Nick and I, in 2008, we moved to a part of Australia called New South Wales, and that state was so big that it got divided into two in terms of regions for CS. And when we moved there in 2008, there were two leaders, so just by moving there, we doubled our Christian Surfers leadership. It was pretty awesome. I was the only woman at that point, and that stretch of coast is amazing. If you go to Australia, you should really go there. It's rocky headlands that go into beautiful white sandy beaches, rainforest that grows down to the beach, dolphins, birds. It's really a very beautiful part of the world. And many of you might have heard of a place called Byron Bay, which is in that section of New South Wales. It's a pretty iconic surf town. And it, back in those days, was known to be a bit of a graveyard for church planters and for Christian Surfers missions. So when we were praying about starting a mission there, there hadn't been a healthy Christian Surfers there for a long time. So we're praying, and this girl, Serena, she would have been in her early 20s at the time, she was the one who put her hand up to lead a CS mission. And she was perfectly placed to start the mission. She was working in a local school as a scripture teacher, so she had connecting with the kids. They knew she was a believer. She was able to talk to them about these things, and then she gathered around her a group of great leaders, young leaders, and they ended up being this fantastic mission there. And I was always so proud of her for putting up her hand, and I think there's two reasons that she was able to do that. And the first one was that she had role models. In Christian Surfers Australia at that time, we had Stephen Kath Bailey leading the nation, and they were very clearly a couple in partnership. They led as a team. Kath was very visibly present in all the Christian Surfers Australia events. She had me as her regional coordinator. There were not, in terms of women rising up through at that point, there were not a heap, but she saw role models. And so that was the main thing. She had some role models, some women that she could look to and see, there is a path, I can do this. And so I just would say to you girls, when you feel like God's asking you to show up, don't forget that there's all these girls behind you who are watching you and who really need to see women on the platform, leading, serving Jesus. So that was the first thing. She had role models. And the second thing was that she had champions. She had men in her life through Christian Surfers who were championing her to step into that role. Again, she had national leaders, she had other regional coordinators, she had Nick, my husband, who's a phenomenal empowerer and releaser. It doesn't matter if you're a girl or a boy, male or female, he will empower and release. And so there were these two pieces that enabled her to step up and have this fantastic mission. And we used to always laugh at our regional camps because she would bring these grommies and they'd turn up and they'd put up their tents and then they'd have their Buddhist prayer flags and they'd drape their Buddhist prayer flags over their tents. And we had a whole bunch of vegans and, back in those days when we ran camps, it was all about the meat. There was lots of meat to be eaten, but we'd have to have our vegan burger patties and sausages for these kids. You know, Byron Bay is like a really interesting place spiritually. The New Ages will tell you it's because the meridian lines converge there, the energy lines of the earth, so it's very significant. It's a really cool place that really needed surfers who loved Jesus to be ministering there. And so, I just wanted to finish with Serena. And I guess this picture to end, just to really petition you guys that together as men and women we represent the image of God, and that as we hear that call that God is going to pour out his spirit on both men and women, that there is a place for both of us at the table, and together we can do this. So I just again would just thank you to all the men here who've been willing to share your platform and been willing to open the door and give women a space. It's a really wonderful thing. And I would just petition you, do that for your wives. Do that for your daughters. Do that for your sisters in Christ. There are women in your mission who have gifts and talents who are just waiting for the opportunity to use them. So, yeah. Thank you. Thank you for listening. Let me pray to finish. Well, Lord, you are good. You're so good to us. And we are in awe of the way that you work. Lord, we thank you for the ministry of Christian Surfers. We thank you for the men and women that have met you through the ministry of Christian Surfers. We thank you for the men and women that you have equipped and released. We thank you for the blessing to the body of Christ that this ministry is, that it has been and is and will continue to be. We thank you for the many pastors ministering in their local communities who've risen up through the ranks of Christian Surfers. We thank you for the promise that you are with us, that you empower us, that you will provide all that we need to fulfill your purposes on this earth. And we just celebrate with you, Lord, the fullness of your vision, that you're willing to come in and make us uncomfortable so that we can seek and save the lost. Yeah, we love you, Jesus, and we pray these things in your mighty, mighty and wonderful name. Amen.
Oh, there we go. You. I'm going to flip the scripture a little bit. I know what I'm supposed to do, but I'm going to change things. So could we go back to that last picture that V ended on? Are you able to stick that up there? Okay. Guys, I want to say that I want to thank you. I want to thank everyone for today. It's been one of the most amazing days. I've done this for a long time in Christian Surfers history. I loved it. And V said something really powerful and profound. She said that picture shows us that together we represent the image of God. But I want to say it's more than that. Together we represent and we will hear the voice of God. We cannot lead this movement without all of us together. There is no way. And I want to thank you because today I heard messages and aspects of the gospel that were just so fresh, so encouraging, and so empowering. So I want to thank everyone from Amy to all of our panelists and to V tonight. It was absolutely fantastic. Thank you for listening to God and bringing his voice and his message into our movement in such a powerful way. I can't wait to see what he's going to do. Father, I want to thank you for what you're doing. I thank you that you're the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and this is how you've designed it. I thank you for this beautiful, sweet space that you have us in, that you're moving us into your glory and you're giving us so much. So I just want to thank you, Lord, for today. Amen. All right, so now you can play the video again. Come on, why not? Yeah. I'm channeling my inner surfer. So Mikey's been amazing. I just want to point out Mikey. Mikey has kept us on track. So good, so good. So there's four things that you need to be Christian surfers. There's only four things, but they are absolutely fundamental. You need to believe in the vision, mission, values, and statement of faith. That is one of the things. That's the cross, that's the center. You need to have a plan to reach surfers, obviously, or create opportunities for them to know and follow Jesus. You need to have a team. You can't do this alone. We don't do that. And you need to have governance or accountability. That's it. That's our DNA. If you have those four things, you can start Christian Surfers. That is really as simple as it is. And we've codified that. We've taken that idea, and we've mapped it down into a set of eight videos. Videos 1, 2, 3, and 4 are kind of giving you the little feeling of what Christian Surfers is, those things. And videos 4 to 8 give you the actual tools and understanding of how to start a Christian Surfers. So we took that and we made it into a video, YouTube video-based platform with a database capture. So if someone anywhere in the world, anywhere in your country, watches those four videos, at video 4 is going to ping them a data thing that's going to come to the office, and we're going to go, oh, this person's from this country or this part of the world, and that data gets shipped back to you. But more than that, we are using it as training. We've done it in English and we've done it in Spanish. And COVID kind of got in the way, but I want to let you know that today, we are launching it in Portuguese and French. So, so what that does is it opens up the whole world, because it opens up so many places in Africa, it opens up so many places all around the world, and I really want to thank the team, I don't know if any of them are watching online, that have helped us put this together, and for those that have translated, it's going to be amazing, and I know that this is really not much time, so I'm going to ask Shane to come up here quickly and just say a little snippet of how he used it and how it worked for him.
And Nina and Dylan. These two helped me lead the foundation training. Okay, so can we put up the picture of the guys all standing next to each other? All right, this is our first foundations training. It ended, I just wanted to give a quick highlight of the first one because it ended with us staying in at a house in San Clemente, and Mikey Wright there, the pro surfer, gave all the boys mullets. And I think I was just thinking about it in the back. It's super cool because two of the guys would have been here tonight, those two, Joey and Cole, but they're actually leading our weekly men's group that we have every Wednesday. So they skipped here because we're not at the men's group. So they're leading it instead. So awesome. Let me get the next picture. Yeah. That one. Stand up if you're there. We have actually like half of our students from foundation training. Look at that. Okay. So we took the first one, and the first one was around here. And we did 8 weeks, one video per week. We surfed, and then we watched the video. And it went really awesome, and there was a lot of fruit from it. So we were like, we want to do this again. How can we make it better? And the three of us met for about 3 months straight, and we planned out this big trip, and we thought the only way we could possibly make it better is add an adventure aspect. So we're like, let's go somewhere in the world with good waves. And so we chose Baja, and we went to a place called Punta Abriojos, which is a 14-hour drive. We loaded everyone up in the van, drove to Baja. It was David's van. He said everything was working great. It wasn't. No AC. It was about 110 degrees all the way down. But we landed. Oh, let's get the next one. At Abriojos. And this spot's very special because it's faced in a way where if it's onshore everywhere else, it's offshore here. So basically, it's just offshore all day, every day. So all you need is a little swell. We had an epic hurricane swell. And we used the foundations training videos as kind of like a baseline curriculum, and then we just built out from there, like really interactive, fun, team stuff. And we were just kind of blown away at the overall fruit. Like, we didn't actually expect it to go that awesome. But I feel like the multiplication factor was just crazy because, I guess my example is there's a kid that came. He's 16. His name's Kenan from Santa Cruz. Yep, got some Santa Cruz guys. And Santa Cruz chapter sent him out, and he really wanted to serve. He was in that group of, like, I attend the chapter, but I don't really know how I fit in with the leadership. And so they sent him to Foundations training, and he just got so fired up. As soon as he got home, he grabbed his whole leadership team, and he's like, okay, I got all these ideas. Like, I know that our chapter is good, but I think it can be better. And I don't want you to do it. I'll do it. I just want you to support me. And so he gathers leaders, and ever since Foundations training, it was funny that V said, just show up, because at Foundations training, the biggest kind of message that we spoke that would, we said, this you'll see the most fruit if you just show up. Just show up, just show up. That was like the theme of the whole week. And so since Foundations training, Kenan has showed up at his surf break every single Saturday morning in the dark to set up the tent and be there, and it's just been insane to watch. So,
and he does a Devo.
And yeah. Actually, I came to visit kind of last minute, and he had planned someone to do a Devo. And this is not a leadership takeaway, but he was so excited that I was coming that he actually said, okay, you're not doing the Devo anymore. I'm doing the Devo. And he kicked the dude out. But I'll stop talking, and I'll give it over to Nina, a highlight from Foundations training.
Okay. Hi. I don't like speaking in public. Okay, never mind. That trip was actually so sick, and I feel like the big takeaway I just got out of it was just really getting to tell people, like, the mission and remind people of, like, the mission of Christian Surfers. I feel like for surfers, it's easy to get distracted just by, like, surfing. Like, I know a lot of the kids originally signed up because we were going to a sick wave, and they're like, sick, surf trip, and, like, not even thinking about Christian Surfers. But it was just so cool because it was, like, a great reminder of why we do what we do. Like, we do this because we want, like, surfers to know Jesus, not to, like, find good waves or, like, always be, like, the one getting all the waves in the water or go to the best spots. It's, like, so people have the opportunity to hear about Christ. And it was just a great reminder for me because, like, at our local chapter, I'm an O-side girl, and I don't like Carl's bad waves, and there's days that I know, like, Oceanside is way better than Carl's bad, but we have, like, the chapter meeting, and in the past, there's been so many times that I've ditched CS, sorry to say, to go surf Oceanside, and I just got so convicted because I was like, this is not why I come to Christian Surfers. I come to Christian Surfers so that, like, people, like, have the opportunity to hear about Christ, and I get to love on, like, my brother and sisters in the water. And so just that idea of, like, coming because you know that the mission is so much bigger, and it's not really about surfing, like, at all. It's about people getting to know Jesus. So that was a really cool highlight.
I think the highlight for me, what? My name's Dylan. A highlight for me was being able to lead this whole thing, well, with the help of them, mainly the help of Shane. yeah. And, well, originally I wanted to attend this leadership thing. Yeah, which I didn't really think I would be leading at the time. And I was like, oh, you know, can I be a part of this? And then Shane asked me, like, can I help lead it? And I was like, oh, whoa, I kind of just want to, you know, be one of the, I don't know, students, I guess, and just, like, kick it with the boys on the beach. But I actually had to put in time and work. but it was good, and it ended up being amazing, and I got to meet a lot of good friends. Yeah, and that was my highlight, was being able to lead it.
Can we skip to the picture with the double glasses? There we go. That's a highlight, too. That's Titus, and he's also helping lead the men's group back at home right now. So that's it. That's all we have.
Dude, I should have had that. You should have done the one.
Wow, that is incredible. Thank you for sharing. We just have a few announcements before we let you guys go tonight. Aldo, you're up for your announcements here. You're announcing about the store.
Yes.
Are you coming up?
Yeah. As this is Women's Night, the characters of my story will be mainly girls. One day, Amy and Eric went surfing. Oh, I have the waves. I have one nice waves out there. And she got a really great wave. Wow. You should take it. But she asked her, as this is a handicraft from South Africa, she was invited, Sharon Harley. So this is a dream, you know? So, oh, thanks. Thanks, Amy, to tell me how to learn to surf. Also, I'm surfing now I'm ripping.
I have no idea what's going on right now.
Then, and she was saying, sorry, give me this. And she was saying, yeah, but you know that they are selling these wonderful bags for wax. Oh, what's wax? Wax is, you put it in the over the servo, and it's good for standing up. But then appear Mr. David Nerick turning into a dolphin. Oh, darling, the kids are alone at home. You need to take them. But meanwhile, he was good doing that. He was saying he was throwing combs for. Wow. You can find those combs in the store of Christian Surfers in the conference. Oh, so tell the boys are messing at the home. Wow. If you want to find all of this stuff and more, of course, there are T-shirts and a lot of things. Then you can just go to the store. And you will find a lot of things. The store is open tonight and the whole day of tomorrow. Am I right?
That is correct. Wow. That is the best announcement I've ever heard. The store will be open tomorrow before the sessions, after the sessions. And I don't know if you picked up on it, but with any purchase you get from Groundswell, you also get a wax comb and a sticker for free. So, don't know if you got that in the whole presentation from Aldo, but that was not something we communicated before. All right, the only other announcement is we just want you guys to start thinking about tomorrow. We have breakouts. We're not going to do our areas. We have a few different ones you can choose from. So I'm just going to let you know what they are. You could think about it tonight, and then you can choose them tomorrow. So, we will have Surf Church Collective breakout session. You do not have to be a part of Surf Church Collective now. If you are interested, if you want to hear more about it, then Rich would love to have you there. Pioneer Affiliates, if you have 1 to 3 chapters, there's going to be a session for you guys. Established Affiliates, those with 3 or more. Adaptive Surfing is going to be doing a session. That should be really cool to check it out. And finally, the last one is the Olympics 2024. So there'll be a session on that. All right, so just start thinking about that, where you want to go, and you guys are free to go tonight. Good job. Thank you.
Teach you how to surf to shore.